Oh, thank you. And good evening and welcome to the November 10th meeting of the Murfreesboro City School Board. We're glad to have those of you that are with us and those that are watching from home. We're glad to have you viewing as well. At this time, I'm going to ask you to please stand as Mr. Jimmy Richardson, our newest board member, will lead us in our pledge, followed by a moment of silence. You'll want to remember our attorney, Elizabeth Taylor, who is as the COVID has attracted that, and also remember Lisa Lowe, an EA at Black Fox, whose father passed away unexpectedly. Jimmy?
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now our moment of silence. Thank you. Okay. Members of the board, you have received a copy of the agenda. Do we have a motion to approve the agenda as printed?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Richardson. We have a second.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Ballard. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you. All right, communications. We'd like to call on Mr. Jimmy Garland, who is the district director for the Mid-Cumberland and Tennessee School Board Association, who is also a member of the Clarksville Montgomery County School Board. Jimmy has a special presentation for us tonight. Mr. Garland.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell and Mr. Ringstaff, Superintendent Ringstaff. Thank you, members of the board. It is my privilege to be here tonight to present you with the TSBA Board of the Distinction Award. I was supposed to have been here in October, but something came up and I wasn't able to make it, but I just thank God that I can make it today. This award is one of TSBA's most prestigious awards. I commend your board for meeting the requirements in four key areas: planning, policy, promotion, and board development. As you know, the requirements are extensive and not every board qualifies as a board of distinction. However, your board is among those select few. And this is my second time in this capacity to present this award. On behalf of the Tennessee School Board Association, I am proud to present the Board of Distinction Award to the Murfreesboro City School Board of Education. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, very much. Appreciate it. It is an effort put forth by this Board of Education. It is a board for.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So much.
All right, communications.
Good evening, board.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you. Murfreesboro City Schools, specifically our community outreach department, would like to thank United Way of Rutherford and Cannon Counties for coordinating a gift card donation from public supermarkets in the amount of $4,940. So we appreciate these type donations tremendously. And of course, those are put out towards our schools and our teachers as needed. Murfreesboro City Schools would also like to thank General Mills. the Foundation for Hometown Grant-Making Program. They just gave us $10,000 for the backpack program. And as you know, the backpack program goes out with students on Fridays for those weekend meals. So General Mills has been so supportive of us for years and years, and we appreciate their support, and we appreciate Publix and everyone who kind of helps us do our job. That's your communications, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, very much. All right, consent items. Do we have a motion to approve the consent items as printed?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Goff. Do we have a second?
Second, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Richardson, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you. All right, let's see. Action items.
Yes, sir. Board policy 6.409, child abuse and neglect. This passed on first reading with us needing to make a few adjustments, and I believe we've done that on the second page, the needed adjustments. I think Ms. Taylor emailed you with an explanation of this. So we recommend approval for second reading.
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Barton. Motion made to approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Settles. Do we have any discussion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Any deficiencies that I found previously in the vote, I believe, have been absolved and resolved with what council's been able to provide. So I will be voting in favor of that.
Thank you, sir. All right, all in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you.
Next policy is 4.302, field trips, excursions, competitions. And what we did, we added lines 7 through 24, independently planned trips. We've all heard of these trips. An employee of a school district is trying to get together a trip to Europe. It doesn't have anything to do with any lessons, anything else. And we want to make sure that legally we're not held liable as a result of this. And it's called independently planned trips, and no board funds, resources shall be used, school district materials shall not be used. And we, and most important, we shall not assume any liability. So we recommend approval of this on first reading.
All right, do we have a motion to approve the policy?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Goff. We have a second.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Ballard. Any discussion? Question? All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you.
The next, each year we have to agree that we're doing everything legally. We have to say that we're doing everything legally in case we're audited. It's the Local Education Agency Compliance Report. And this sheet, it includes that we agree that we are having the appropriate length of school day, teacher assignments, salaries and licensure for all licensed personnel, class size, planning time, duty-free lunch, student report cards, and admission and enrollment of students, and students transferring from one school to another. And I'm here to tell you that we are doing those things legally. So we recommend that you, it must be approved by the school board tonight. It's got to be turned in by November 30th.
Mr. Chairman, I move for approval.
Thank you, Mr. Settles. We have a second.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Goff. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you.
Next is approval of synchronous learning days. Now, we get a lot of questions. What does asynchronous mean? Synchronous, I don't know if the state came up with these terms or not, but synchronous, without the A, means direct learning from a teacher at that time. Asynchronous is a student learns basically on their own. They are assigned work and they do it on their own. So our teachers need planning time. Our teachers need planning days to plan for the next 3 or 4 weeks. So we are asking you to approve 3 asynchronous learning days. One is the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, November the 24th. The second day, and we need to spread these out a little bit so teachers can plan and then do the teaching for that period of time. And then we have another asynchronous learning day. That's planned on Friday, February the 5th. And the third one is Friday, March the 19th. These are Fridays. This will enable our nutrition staff to provide all students with a breakfast and lunch for that next day. They will take it home on Thursday and eat it on Friday and have it available on Friday. The first time it will be sent home with them on Monday, November the 23rd. This ESP will be open if parents need childcare from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. at all schools. And our teachers need this. So we recommend that you approve this on our calendar.
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Barton. We have a second.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Settle. Mr. Ringstaff, where do these days come from?
Well, they're still counted as days in our calendar because the students are learning. District-wide, our instruction department will be providing assignments district-wide. So that takes a little bit off the teachers as well.
So this is not one of those stockpile days?
No, sir.
Okay. Ms. Barton?
Obviously, I've told you both that I think this is a fabulous idea. I just want to be sure that in no way we let any type of other meetings take place on those 3 days. Those teachers need those full days. No, and you know I love all those people, but no instructional coach meetings, no anybody meetings. I mean, they need to meet with their grade level and plan all day for 3 days. And that won't be enough, but it's a good faith effort that we're at least giving it to them.
And I'll be honest with you, the November 24th day, we will need to meet with all kindergarten teachers throughout the day for 1 hour. I think it's Zoom.
Zoom.
Okay. It's for 1 hour. It's state mandated to talk about the portfolio. And that's only on November 24th.
Okay.
Mr. Settle?
And I want to kind of piggyback with Roseanne because I think it's so important that we give teachers more of this time. And is this the first time we've done anything like this?
Yes, sir.
Statewide at all. And so this may be the beginning of seeing some of this. And I think you weren't joking. You kind of said, I think this may be the end of snow days, in a sense. We're learning more, I know, with the coronavirus forcing everybody to rethink everything. And it may be that some of these days, or a lot of them even, or if we're out for inclement weather, that kids can still learn and we won't have to drop it all together. I think this is great. I think this is where we're headed. So I'm in support of this. When I heard about it, I was all for it. So I'm just voicing my support.
Mr. Richardson?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ringstaff, do we believe that we will need additional days such as these in the future as we go into 2021?
Mr. Richardson, that is a possibility. We will evaluate that in February. Our testing window for TCAP 10 ready, I think, is the second week of April. So that's the important thing, that we get the teachers to plan before the testing period, and then we will evaluate that and come back to you if we need to do that.
Very
we have a little bit of time to evaluate that.
Thank you, Mr. Ringstaff.
Yes, sir.
Ready for the vote.
Any other question? Mr. Ballard?
Ralph, thank you. I remember we talked about, you know, getting the input from the teachers and everyone on setting this up and doing it. What about parents? Where do they weigh in?
Well, we've offered ESP if they need childcare, and we've given them over 2 weeks' notice that we're going to do this. So we've taken their concerns into consideration.
Okay.
Mr. Richardson?
Mr. Chairman, I apologize for multiple questions. Mr. Ringstaff, do these days also line up with what the county has?
No, sir. They do not.
Thank you.
Let me add, in the past, we have had professional development days built into the calendar that are different from the county.
So we've had discussion, we've had a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ringstaff. All right, budget transfers and amendments.
Uh,
Per board policy, we have to bring any line item transfers within major categories to the school board for approval. There's two budget transfers. One is we have to reclassify something because the state told us to, and another is we had some overages in one of the health slash nursing line items, and we moved some money to cover that. So those are the two budget transfers, and then we have to bring budget amendments to the board. And then in addition, once those are approved by the board or any discussion, they would go on to city council. And what those are is additional, any additional expenditures in addition to what y'all would have approved for the normal budget. With these right here, though, we're not asking. We have revenues that, that balance these. And one budget amendment actually increases fund balance, if you would say, for ESP. We got a loss of income grant. So that'll go into fund, you know, salaries or any overages we may have due to that. It was a COVID-related grant. So that's what these are on the in front of you.
So these are just basically transferring from one line item to the other.
The first two are in your packet. They're two budget transfers. They are within a major category. All we're doing is moving two account codes. One is $40,000, and that is required by the state. They wanted us to move that. It is from a 399 code to a 312. They just wanted it when they come, they send an email and they'll want something changed. And so we have to do that. And then the other one, we were going to be over budget in the health equipment line item, and we had some money to move from supplies and materials. And so board policy states that we bring those to you and get those approved. And those two that I just mentioned do not go to council because they're not increasing expenditures in total. They just kind of wash. But then the other ones actually increase expenditures. However, we have revenues that have come in, grant money, that offset those. So we're not asking for any additional funding, you know, or anything out of fund balance. But those are required to come to you as well. And then per board policy, we have to take those on to city council. So.
Do we have a motion to approve the transfers?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms.
Moore.
Excuse me. Have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Settles. Any questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Okay.
Next, we have the personnel report. I'm still happy to announce that we have no certified resignations in the last 3 months. So that may not be true around winter break time, though. We may have one or two at that time. But we've moved some custodians from part-time to full-time for second shift to try to improve our retention of custodians. Knock on wood, so far it's worked, but we've only been doing it for 2 or 3 weeks. Are there any questions about that?
Okay. No, but I do want to thank you. I think that was a smart move with the custodians. A very smart move. People are nervous right through here. I think that's really good.
Well, do we have a motion then to approve the personnel report?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Richardson. Have a second.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Goff. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you. Enrollment report.
Good evening, board.
Good evening.
This is a complicated report, so, and my very first time to share it, so bear with me. At the bottom of the report on the left-hand side in the yellow box reports our average attendance percentage for this past 20-day period, and that was 95%. That's about standard for where we are, especially with everything that's going on. To the right of that report, that section, is the regular education PTR, pupil teacher ratio. And if you'll notice there that for grades kindergarten through third grade, our PTR is 18.22 students per teacher. For fourth grade through sixth grade, it's 19.88, for a total of 18.80 across the district. So that's where we're below requirements and where we need to be. To the right of that is the information about growth over this past year. And last year we had 9,258 students at this time. We're 377 students short, but that is an improvement from the previous report. At the last report after the first period, we were down 451 students. So that's a growth of about 74 students. So we have seen some growth as we brought students back from distance learning back into the building. We've seen some growth from that. And just one note, I've always wanted to say this, and so now that I have this opportunity, on the right-hand side, where you see the numbers for special education, I've always thought that was a little confusing. I want to make sure that the board is clear on that. You all heard from Ms. Fairchild's report back at the retreat, but that number is more like 1,200 students that we have in special education. And this number that's on this report just represents those students who are in the most intensive programs, the CDC classrooms, behavior classrooms, and the deaf education programs. So I wanted to just make sure that you as you look at these numbers, that was still clear to you all. And that's the report. Yes, sir.
Mr. Settles?
You did mention distance and in-person, but this is total, right?
This is total, yes, sir.
So distance and in-person combined altogether, and we've gained how many back from the, because we're at a negative 377 before we were at a negative
451. So that's a growth of 74 students during this time period. Now, with today ended the 20-day period, we'll have the report at the next time that we share this report with you. We'll have that report put together as we get those numbers in. So we're at that juncture at this point. So,
Joe, do we have any idea where these other 300 some odd students are?
I'm glad you asked, because I asked that same question. And so in talking with Mr. Ringstaff, with Mr. Lyles, we have about 150 more students that this year chose to participate in homeschooling, and that's parent choices. And so that's a number that's part of that 377. And then we know that we have about 100 kindergarten students that did not enroll this year, whose parents made the determination to keep them home since they're not required to send them at age 5. And so we probably will see an uptick next year in that number of kindergartners that but so that accounts for about 250, maybe a few more of that 377.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Wes?
Mr. Merlin, I appreciate your taking this over, and I welcome the opportunity for you to look at this chart and figure out how to simplify it.
Well, again, I'm glad you said that. Normally boards get this report about twice a year. And this report helps us out a lot at the central office level. I'm not sure that it makes a lot of sense to you all. And we can definitely watch for trends without having to do all this. This report does create a lot of work for our personnel, our attendance clerks who, today are working on that 20-day report. This is sort of done separately, so it's almost like double duty. So if the board is willing at some point, I'd love to present that as a proposal that we only look at this a couple of times a year. It's really important that we have this at the beginning of the school year when we're trying to decide where teachers are needed and where our numbers are, going up or numbers are going down. But, as far as looking at this on an every month basis, I don't know that it's very critical.
Ms. Barton?
I see what you're saying, Joe, but quite honestly, and of course it does mean something to me. So I like seeing it every month because I like to see when a grade level gets particularly high to school and try to find out what's going on there.
Sure.
So, we don't have to discuss it in length every month, but I do like seeing it.
And we're looking at these numbers all the time. It's, we don't always look at them in this format.
Sure.
And ask for that report. But yes, we can, whatever the board decides, it is an interesting report.
I've always thought the same thing. That's so interesting that now that we're discussing it, I remember Mr. Anderson would say, at certain times it was really important, and then other times he was like, well, here it is. So I think if the information is there and it can be gathered into some type of format to drill down the stuff that really, that sticks out, that's important, because I'm always interested in the student to teacher ratio, but it doesn't change that often throughout the year. So I'm always interested to see it. And we always beat the state average, which I love. I think that's great. It's just something else that for us to brag about. because we have one of, we have probably the best school system in the state of Tennessee. So I don't know if I get that. I think that's good. I think if it's available to see, I don't know that I have to talk about it every month either. I'm with Roseanne. We don't have to go in depth on it, but if it's available or shot out in an email or something, we can talk about it later.
We'll look to see if there are any ways we can improve it or change it to make it more understandable or.
Because it is a lot of information to take in. Whenever I get this, my eyes glass over. Because it looks like one of the, what is our accounting guys? Oh yeah, it looks like something that they would just love. Oh, this is just delicious. Not to me, it's not.
Mr. Richardson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You said it's sort of extra work. Is it duplicative of other work?
Yes, the report that they turn in every 20 days goes to the state, looks at some of these numbers, but not all of this. And so when we look at, and you'll see the numbers in pink, and we go back and review those on a regular basis, it means that they sort of have to do that check-in, where we're always going to be keeping up with that pupil-teacher ratio. Some of these numbers on here don't really relate to that ratio, just like I said, just like the special education numbers. But all those are important numbers for us to look at, and so we'll keep doing it if that's what the board decides.
Very well, thank you.
Ms. Goff?
Yes, I wanted to follow up on Butch's question because I was actually sitting here wondering about the students that we don't have in school, and you said they're homeschooled. Do we have a way of tracking them and making sure they're not just kept at home? We do follow up with them because I would hate for students to just get left out.
Well, one of the things that we're required, and talking about attendance, and I can talk about that, and Sherry can tell you more about the instruction part of it, but we do have to check in with them so we can make sure that they are participating, so in order to be able to count them as present. So that's, and we'll still count students truant if they're not participating. That's, you know, if you're not participating online and completing your work, that's the same as not being at school, and that leads to, you know, truancy issues as well. So we still monitor those.
Well, I think you talked about homeschool and not virtual learning.
Oh, homeschool.
Yeah.
Well, I misunderstood. Homeschool, we don't have anything other than, yeah, Mr. Lyles can tell us more about that as far as what our requirements are, but the state requirements are very minimal for those.
As far as being able to track homeschool students?
Yeah, if we don't, yeah, go ahead.
I work with the attendance clerks very closely, and they don't withdraw students unless they have word from me that parent has completed the paperwork for homeschool or verified, give us verification that they've enrolled in an online program. And so once I get that, or once the school gets that, then they will withdraw students from their roster.
Mm-hmm.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I just don't want to lose students, lose children in the system, and they're not getting an education, and we, you know, maybe parents aren't accountable, and, you know.
And that's based on the students that have, like, were enrolled in our schools. Now, that's not count. I mean, I'm sure there are kids out there that have moved to the city that we don't know about because they haven't enrolled in our schools. But for students that have been enrolled in our schools, we do work with the attendance clerks to make sure that they are in some kind of program.
Okay.
Ms. Barton?
Another reason, the average attendance percentage, I mean, that used to be something, and I think it still is, that we're measured on in our report card, is it not?
Not the average percentage. We're measured by chronic absenteeism, so we look at, that's a different number. That's the number of students who have missed more than 10% of the school year.
Right.
We just got back, and Board, you remember the lengthy report I gave you at the retreat about some of that data. We just got back a few more pieces of that data, which is really interesting that it came back after our reports were due. But last year we had about 638, and it's, you know, it's interesting that I remember that number, but it, for some reason it stuck with me. 638 kids across our district that missed more than 10%.
Mm-hmm.
So that's more than 18 days. That does combine excused and unexcused absences. And so that's the number that the state actually tracks, more than this percentage.
What is their requirement? I'm sorry to interrupt you. What is their requirement?
Their requirement?
Do they have a a maximum number of students that we shouldn't, a percentage of students that we...
They look at us and at comparable districts, and if you remember, well, you wouldn't because I didn't get to talk about that day, but our percentage as a district is about 6% lower than comparable districts, so we're actually doing a good job, but we still have 638 students that have missed that many days. And of course, you'll probably remember this back from when I was in the instruction department, we talked about everyday matters, the importance of students being and how that's really the parents' responsibility to get them to school because it makes a significant difference. And so that's where the state, you know, began to look at that issue, and that's how we're measured as a part of our accountability.
Are we still pursuing truancy charges against parents? And if we are, who's doing that?
Elizabeth Taylor does that.
She's
responsible, yes.
And how are we as far as, I know it's hard to judge because I can't really remember a statistic, but I don't know, a percentage of students that we are going to truancy court with for?
We'd have to ask Elizabeth. I don't get that number as far as that goes. And we do have a process. You know, we have a continuum now that we have to go through in order to get to that spot where we can even go to court.
Right.
And so we're working with that. As a matter of fact, I met with one attendance person yesterday and two people today, two of our attendance staff and school counselors who were working on that in their schools. So to give them some guidance and help them, you know, think about how to work through that process.
Yeah. I
think for the first couple months,
especially with COVID, it's going to be a nightmare.
I think for the first couple months, we gave them a little grace period.
Okay.
But we're following up with that now, you know, through that process as we see, as students said, that first couple of months had difficulty as parents were trying to figure out what exactly they were going to do, but.
Is there not somewhere on the report card or something that where it gives the average attendance?
It's not done quite that way now. It's done a different way. But yes, attendance does figure into it.
Attendance does figure into it, but it doesn't talk about this percentage here of average daily attendance.
Okay.
It talks about the number of students who are chronically absent.
I got you. Okay. All right.
That's what's measured.
So it's important, I guess is my point.
Yeah.
All right, any other questions to Mr. Marlin? Right, do we have a motion to approve the attendance report, enrollment report?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Richardson. Have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Moore. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? And there is none. Thank you.
Next, Mr. Smith. These are for informational purposes.
Is there any, this is the document I think y'all are used to getting probably once a month.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any, first, is there any questions on this that y'all have particular on? And then second, if there's something y'all want additional, this is just what I know y'all are used to getting. I don't mind preparing it. Just let me know and we can, if you want something in addition to this.
Thank you. Mr. Richardson.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, and thank you. I'll pose the question to you. Is there information that you think we ought to know that's not on that report?
I'm looking into maybe changing this report a little bit, but I've only been here a month, so we'll see. I want to make it a little simpler. I want this information to be available, but I'd like something maybe a little simpler to let you know where we're at as far as that goes. Are we having a healthy fund balance? Are we on track? Something a little simpler. But I'm still working on that, you know, so.
Very well. Thank you.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Smith, again, welcome to Murfreesboro City Schools. And in the budget process, I think to me, what I'm most interested in understanding is the 30,000 foot view of it, you know, that, mm-hmm. and your responsibility to tell us when we're about to go into the hole.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I could read this report and I can see, basically work my way through it. But it helps a whole lot to know that, hey, we're getting hit with we've got to buy a new bus and we're going to get, this is where it's coming from and this is what we're going to spend, or any other unforeseen mm-hmm. expenses that are going to affect the end of the year outcome.
My thought process too is maybe to include a page of notes with this that hits the high points. That's probably one of my first things. If y'all found that useful, I can do mm-hmm. that. But like I said, I want to go ahead and prepare what was regularly prepared. And then go from there. So I'll prepare maybe a cover sheet kind of for this, hit some of the high points, go ahead and explain to you what the differences are, what they are, and you can just read through there. And then if you want to dive in, I can, you know, obviously we can dive in as deep as you want to go, but if some kind of cover sheet, we could start there if that would help y'all.
Thank you. Ms. Moore?
I think that would be really helpful because usually we don't get that until this presentation, and I like to kind of, yep. That would be helpful for the preparation for the meeting to see.
Yeah, I'd be glad to. We can make it as part of the board packet. I'll send it in as that. So thank kind you. Of explain some of the differences, where we're at, are we on our own track? I can definitely do that.
Need a deep dive?
We can go.
All right. You want to present our budget timeline?
I can go ahead and do that. I guess y'all all have a copy of the tentative budget timeline.
Mm-hmm.
So we've met on this, you know, at central office, and this is kind of a tentative timeline that we've come up with. The one that we'll definitely need y'all's input on is if you look down there in April, there's some board work sessions. You know, those kind of dates are a little bit in limbo as far as, you know, with y'all's schedules and stuff like that. But we're going to start definitely November 30th, you see there at the top, sending out budget request forms and things to principals and department heads. And if you look there, that gives them a full 3 weeks to get that back to us. And that way it gets it to us early so we can start preparing the budget before we go into January and February, which really gets into some of our estimates.
And we get our forms at the same time.
Yes. Yes. And so you'll still get those forms. And if there's something on those forms y'all would like to change a different format, you let me know. As of right now, we'll probably send out what looks like in the prior year. So that's kind of how that goes. Looking down through here, it's pretty close to last year. We're sending out those budget request forms maybe a half a week earlier just to try to give them some more time. And then we request them back. The 18th is the day before Christmas break. And that gives finance staff, gives us some time. We work a few days during Christmas break, gives us some time to get those compiled. And then we essentially submit all those requests to maintenance if there's some kind of big purchase. We submit that to maintenance and kind of rank those a priority. And then additionally, that allows me to communicate with the city if we're going to need to request any type of capital funding for any kind of major project. So,
Ms. Barton?
I have a question, and you all may have, but did administrators in the schools have any opportunity to input with the facility needs assessment? Because I personally think having used it could use a lot of work, but just saying.
We'll do those meetings as that they've done in the past.
Gotcha.
With each principal and each department head.
Cool.
Yeah, we'll definitely, everybody has a slot, so we'll meet with every principal, every department head. Some department heads will meet with twice, and so
right.
If one department head is kind of over two, then we'll bring them in together and those kind of things.
Mr. Ballard?
You know, one other thing, on this report, I don't know how we would get to, and you can probably figure out a great way for us to be able to understand, or me to be able to understand, how the COVID impact, how it's working with this budget. In other words, if we come up with buckets of money, then where are the buckets of money and how do we identify those buckets? Or if we're spending buckets of money that we're not refilling, how we're doing that? So, and I'm sure, and Mr. Ringstaff, we probably know we've got some monies that we've spent that we're kind of like, how are we doing this, but we're doing it?
Yeah,
and that kind of worries me a little bit.
Yeah.
And let me say too, the report you saw previously that we talked about, that I was going to make a cover sheet, I'm going to talk about some of those things in there. I'm going to talk about some of the things. We have some taxes, without diving too much into detail, we have some taxes that have come in over what we estimated. We had some business taxes that came in. I'm going to cover all of that in your monthly kind of cover sheet and highlights that would kind of hint at some of that. Some of our expenses came over and some came under. For instance, transportation, we're not doing as many field trips. That came under a little bit. Business tax came over additional revenue because they extended the filing deadline. So all of those things I'll cover in your monthly report. So it'll cover the COVID things, but it'll also cover anything additional. Is that kind of what you're what you're wanting? So we'll cover that. And then obviously, as we get into more of the board work sessions and stuff like that, we'll talk about, I'll have that information available as far as budgeting for the next year. Hey, you know, we need to look at this related to COVID or this grant related to COVID, those kind of things will all be covered as part of our budget assessment and budget needs.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, sir, very much. Appreciate it. All right, Mr. Ringstaff?
Yes, sir. Next, I would like to introduce Sarah Walker. She's our nursing supervisor, and Ashley Archer, who is, I guess, Sarah's second in command. Our nurses have done an outstanding job. They worked tirelessly. I think Sarah and I, we probably talk on the phone, unfortunately, 3 or 4 times a day, including weekends. And so I've asked Sarah to just give a presentation on what all the nurses do.
So, good evening, board. You guys know me, Sarah. This is Ashley. Like Mr. Ringstaff said, she has been instrumental in what I do and what our nurses do. She has been right there working the extra hours with me and the other nurses, going above and beyond. So I've just put together a little presentation about what the nurses are currently doing for COVID and what they, on top of what they normally do every day. Our school district has 16 full-time nurses. We have one nurse in every building. We have currently for COVID one part-time nurse and one health room aide that floats to wherever we may need her. She pretty much hangs out with us at our office because we all also see children there too, our students. So that's where she hangs out most of the time. We have one full-time float, and she is stationed at a school with a high acuity currently. She does float when we need her to. We have Ashley, our district support nurse. We also have one very tech-savvy nurse who does a lot of our, currently we're doing, we have all the Google Drives and spreadsheets and questions and forms and all that. So she gets all that together for us. She's revamped our whole CPR to make that online. She just is fantastic. So she does that. We have We have a combined total of 241 years of nursing experience at Murfreesboro City Schools. So lots of experience. These ladies know what they're doing. I don't even question it. They are fantastic at what they do. The nursing responsibilities during COVID. So this is just a little overview of what they do. So they take the, obviously for their buildings, they take the COVID reports anytime, day, night, weekends. If someone calls and says it's a positive, the nurse steps in the gear, they contact trace those positive cases immediately. Lots of times it's at night or on the weekend. So they have all their binders, all their paperwork, everything at home with them. So that if that happens, which it frequently does, they call me, tell me what's going on. I send that. I call Ralph. We talk often, like he says. I call him, tell him what's going on. The nurse is in contact with their principal. They get the letters out, the dates, all of that goes out immediately. We do that as soon as possible. I don't think it's ever been more than an hour from the time we find out to the time we get that class quarantined. If they're in the building, when they find out and they have to send the class home, they get that done immediately. They get people in the school, they start calling to have those children picked up and sent home. They also do the daily absentee investigation. So along with attendance, they are taking almost all of the calls for attendance. If they call in, they get a list every day of what kids are out and they call them. Find out, you know, why they're out. If they're sick, then they go through all of the, you know, sick guidelines, figure out what day they can come back. They chart that in Skyward where the teachers can see it, the principals, the bus drivers, everyone has what day that those students can come back. They also chart it in our nursing program so we can run reports and all of that on there. They frequently, since we've had so many staff out and not enough to cover our isolation room. They frequently work in their clinic and the isolation room and call all the attendants. They've done all their education in their building for their staff, students, everybody that has anything, you know, any different job. I know everyone's working extra, and the nurses are there to, you know, help as much as they can. We all know things change frequently, all the time. Sometimes in an hour, they'll, you know, things will change from one thing to another. They stay on top of all of that. They are reading and, you know, researching everything all the time. As for our employees, Ashley and I do all of the contact tracing for our employees. So anytime an employee is out, sick, quarantined with their children, a household member is being tested, any reason that they would be out for COVID, they fill out a form that goes directly to a spreadsheet. That spreadsheet comes to me and Ashley. We investigate every single one of them. About 75% of them, I would say, we have to call to figure out dates, when they can come back. We send an email to every single employee that's out with their return date. If we know it, if they're out being tested, then they follow up and we follow up with another email. That goes to the principal or their supervisor, human resources, everybody is in the loop. We actually make the determination for each employee what those dates are gonna be, what the situation is. You know, if we have any questions, we contact the health department frequently. The communication this year between everybody is phenomenal. It's a team effort. I mean, from the teachers to the principals to the nurses, everybody, attendance. I hate, because I'm always like, I don't want to leave anybody out, but everybody has done such a phenomenal job. I mean, I hear things from other districts across the country, and we have gone above and beyond what we could possibly do. It's amazing to me. Like I said, we have frequent communication with the health department. We talk to them almost daily, I think. Yeah. So on top of all of the COVID responsibilities, the nurses also have their everyday responsibilities that they deal with. Of course, our main goal is to keep those kids in class. This year's a little different. It's unfortunate because we have to send multiple kids home. We don't like to do that because our goal is to keep them in the class. Last year, and minus a couple months, the nurses across the district saw sick and injured visits, over 19,000 sick or injury visits, on top of over 13,000 med visits where they are passing meds or dosing diabetics, with a total over 32,000 visits in 13 schools. That's quite a bit. Like I said, our goal is to get them back. We send most of those back to class. Throughout the district, we have 17 diabetics. We have a few more, but some are at home on distance. Tube feeds, catheters, lots of procedures. Immunization compliance, they make sure the state has not given us any leeway on kindergarten immunizations, so they are still calling and getting immunization records. We are right on track where we always are right now. Very few left. I think our highest number of non-compliant, we don't have, is 5 in the last maybe 5 years, I think. And we are right on track, doing great with that. Normally we help with screenings with coordinated school health. They are all contactless, so they were able to do their screenings without the nurses, but the nurses still do the referrals for vision, hearing. They send out letters and call. They still are certifying their staff in CPR. It's a little different, but that's mandated by the state for our code blue teams, and they are still doing that. Bus drivers, ESP. We normally teach hands-on CPR for all of fifth grade. I hope there is some way that we can continue to do that this year. And we are working desperately to figure that out. Constant communication with our pediatricians. Dr. Johnson is our medical advisor, and we have him on speed dial. He helps us with whatever we need, as well as 504 and IEPs that they, you know, sit in on and help out with. The list could go on, but I was given 5 minutes. I'm probably over that. So I just want to say thank you to all of the nurses, all of the, I mean, they have gone above and beyond, working more hours than you could think of. The teachers, the principals, everyone who has, you know, helped us get where we're at and stay in school. So, next, any questions for me?
All right, Mr. Richardson and Ms. Barton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Are you finding any areas where your needs exceed what you have available to you?
I mean, the nurses are working a lot of hours. So between phone calls and, you know, seeing their kids. So staffing, but there's not a whole, you know, a whole lot we can do. We have in the past week talked with Mr. Ringstaff, and we are getting some subs to come in a couple days a week so we can get them out and help. So hopefully that will help a little bit.
Good, because y'all, all of our teachers, our EAs, our principals, y'all are on the front line, so we rely on you for that information. So is there anything of need beyond your wonderful presentation? Can we help in some way?
I mean, just, you know, talking to the public, just that our parents, making sure that our parents are not sending their kids to school sick, our employees aren't coming to school sick. That is a big issue, is people coming to work sick or coming to school sick. And if we can stop that, maybe we can stop the spread in our school a little bit.
Very well, thank you very much.
Ms. Barton.
And what you're saying is so nice and sweet, Sarah, but what we really need to say is thank you is not enough. If you'll remember last year when we talked about budget, I mentioned that our nurses are making less than a whole lot of people, and they're definitely one of the lower paid groups in our school system. I mean, even with a degree, they're still one of the lower paid professionals, particularly. You know, I know raises are hard, it's money, although I wonder about COVID cares, but that's okay. But what about comp time or anything? Because they are working nights and weekends. And I don't mean like every once in a while, I mean like every weekend they get phone calls, black box, fitter, whoever's got a class, quarantine, contact tracing, who do we call, who else has to go? So I mean, and it takes a while, you know, it's not just like a phone call and they're done. I mean, it takes hours to do what they're doing. So I know, Ralph, I mean, I understand our hands are tied with money, but if there's something we could do, and I'm not saying everybody's not working hard, but like I said, they make less than teachers do, and they are professionals, they have degrees, and they're not making what our teachers do. So
let me ask you a question, and I agree with what you're saying. Sarah or Ralph, are our nurses paid salaried or hourly, or a combination of?
RNs are paid salary, and LPNs are basically non-exempt employees. RNs are exempt employees.
You got that right, right?
Yes.
So RNs are salaries, and everybody else is hourly.
It's broken down by hourly because they're non-exempt employees. They can get overtime pay if they work over 40 hours.
So if they're working weekends, they're getting time and a half, basically?
Yes.
No?
They are?
I hope.
No.
No.
Okay, we'll have to correct that.
Yeah.
And I realize, and I'm like Roseanne, I realize the budget and all that, and I realize what the state gives, and I know that we are above and beyond what the state allots for our system, but that's okay. Those are positions that we need. A visit, is that, if I'm the student and I come to you, that's one visit?
Correct.
So then all these numbers are 19,000 individual students, maybe not different ones, but some of them, you know, but that each one is a visit.
Correct.
Okay. All right. Well, I can only say thank you very much, and I hope that we can come up and find more help.
They come better than that.
Well,
I mean, thank you very much, but that's not enough.
Yeah, it's not enough, but it's the best. That's all we know we can do.
Well, nothing really can compare. There's two professions immediately that face us as school boards that we cannot literally pay enough: teachers and nurses. We just can't. It would be impossible. I mean, there's just not enough money to pay you guys what you're worth. I could. You know, I couldn't do it, teacher or nurse. You know, I had my grandson come over to my house one day out of the week, and, you know, I want to ship him back off real quick. So, you know, his teacher, God love her. I mean, she's probably got angel wings somewhere, but I couldn't do it. And nursing on a regular or in a regular school year is already arduous and wrought and fraught with, you know, sniffles and sneezes and vomit and all the rest of the stuff that you guys have to put up with, and just add COVID on top of it. God love you for not walking. I mean, but it has to be a calling. It has to be something that you love, you know, and I'm going to presume that the nurses that we have love what they do, and understand that we cannot pay them what they're worth. So
they do this obviously without pay. Like, of course that would be absolutely fantastic, but they're still here.
Yeah.
And they are still working. Yeah. I had one tonight that was the last one in the building. So and that's happened to us a few times.
Sure.
And most of our employees probably have emails from us at 9, 10 o'clock at night, because yeah. That's when we get it done.
Well, it's almost 24/7.
It really is.
Pretty much.
Seriously.
If there's a way to sniff out some grant money or something, I'm all for it. I don't know who to contact.
And another big legislation is a big thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think the state only pays for three of our nurses.
Exactly.
Right.
So legislation is big. And I know they've been talking about it, but never comes.
Maybe this will tip it up.
I hope so.
Ms. Moore.
Thank you. I wanted to follow on Roseanne's point, which I think is a very good one. And I'm curious about just how the hours are looking. So RNs, we're not keeping track of RNs hours since it's a salary position, but presumably we are with the LPNs, and I'm wondering how that's comparing. I mean, but for an hourly wage where we're actually logging how many hours and paying by hour versus a salaried RN, I mean, have things gone out of whack because there are so many hours required for everyone right now?
And I'll have to get those numbers and get okay. back with you on that. I don't have those numbers.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens then? Does it fall back on an RN who is a salary? I mean,
they just
or you just do it without pay?
They, like, so they came in a week early, We paid them for some of that week, and then we comped out two of those days for, I mean, if we gave them all comp days, we wouldn't have any nurses in the building and be in trouble. So like our, the asynchronous days, and well, what was our in-service days, like one of our asynchronous days, we're gonna meet for an hour and then they'll be off as comp time.
I think, and I may be wrong, somebody can check me for sure, but a few years ago, we had the same situation in the school system with secretaries getting substitute teachers. And according to the state and the Department of Labor, even if that nurse is paid a salary, that salary is based on a 40-hour week. And anything over that is overtime.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way it was back then.
As long as they're not non-employed.
And I would assume that it's probably the same now. So we're probably getting a lot of bang for our dollars. Well, I know we are from our school mm-hmm. nurses. They are.
Oh, yeah.
They are. And it's gone on before, but it's even more so now with COVID, because we all know, you know, we get emails from Ralph on the weekends, who it's come from after discussion with y'all on classes that have had to be quarantined. So we know he's working on the weekends. So we also know that others are working on the weekend as well. I think this is a thing, board, that we need to really look at when it starts budget
time.
I really
before
do.
Before that, what can we do?
Well,
I don't want to wait till budget time. I mean, we need, and I know it's hard because I get it. I know money's money, but at least if you all started logging hours so that we could see, because I'm telling you, and y'all know, it's going to be ridiculous how many extra hours they're working a week and not getting paid for it. I mean, and I know we're not doing that intentionally. I'm not saying anything bad about us or Ralph or anybody else. I'm just saying it's something that needs to be righted.
Well, maybe a good little experiment to do.
Mm-hmm.
Tell everybody in your category.
In their
start,
free time.
Start logging their hours. And then let's look at it and see.
Some of them probably are. So.
Well,
I hope they are.
Probably might be on a good start.
Okay,
there.
Mr. Richardson.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for recognizing me. I'm not sure if this would be a better question for Mr. Ringstaff or for you. How do our COVID numbers compare to similarly situated districts? Are we higher? Are we lower? And I throw that to everybody.
Well, I've done some research, and for the last 2 weeks, they haven't been good. I'll just be honest. But that's across the state. That's across all school districts. And I'm gonna give you the numbers for the year. Since August 10th, the last 13 weeks, we've had, since last Friday, not today, since last Friday, we had 52 staff to test positive. 73.
And what, 52 staff?
52 staff have tested positive for the last 13 weeks. 73 students have tested positive. So that's 125. In a 13 week period, that's about 10 per week. We've quarantined 67 classes, which is about 5 per week. We've quarantined 1,113 students, and 155 staff have been quarantined. So if you compare our grade levels to other districts, we compare pretty favorably. I'm pleased with the work that our nurses, our teachers, our EAs, nutrition, transportation. I mean, we have bus drivers taking temperatures right now. We're stepping up our game. But when I hate having to send you an email. I hate reporting that we've had a case. And one case is too many. I take it personal. I think it was yesterday, we kept getting cases before I could email you with the last case. And so we met as a central office team yesterday, and we did a scenario. What if we had to shut down school A? We don't have enough subs to cover the number of staff that have been quarantined. We don't have enough students. What if we have to shut them down? What would it look like? Number one, we would have to shut down ESP as well. If it's not safe enough for any of our students, right. It's not safe enough for ESP. How soon could we get the computers out to them? We're going to shut down the school for 2 weeks. That's the worst case scenario. What would that look like? We determined that we could get every student a computer who needed one within 2 days. Those 2 days that they don't have a computer, it would be asynchronous learning days like we have. But again, that's the worst case scenario. We hope we never have to close a school, not for a day, not for 2 days. We know our goal is to keep our schools open. And we've done a really good job of keeping the individuals inside our school from getting the virus inside our schools. Mm-hmm. Our problem is when it's brought inside our school. That's the problem. But we can only think of maybe 3 or 4 situations out of 125 that they possibly could, a person could possibly could have gotten it inside our schools. Out of 125, that's pretty good percentages.
Yes.
Now, I would like to say this. Our employees are stressed and they're fearful right now. I even have those same concerns. I get stressed, I get fearful. But I do want to encourage all of our employees to hang in there for 2 more weeks. And then 2 weeks from tomorrow begins our Thanksgiving break. And then we get winter break 3 weeks after that. Those are well-deserved breaks for all employees, teachers, EAs, nutrition, transportation. All of our employees deserve those breaks, and they're needed. And we want our employees to rest and recharge for when we come back in January, when we can be ready to take care of our students. Our children need us. We know that. So we will shut down a school only if it's necessary, our last resort.
I hate to ask, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Ms. Barton.
I hate to ask, but I'm picturing the scenario. Are we still gonna stay away from combining classes? Because that was a thing we were gonna try not to do, and I don't know, we may have already had to do that, but you only have so many grown-ups in the school that can be in one place at one time. And I honestly don't see how you haven't hit that yet. I mean, how we haven't had to close a school yet, just because I know just simply from a Friday in May, you know, good Lord, with the people I had out, it was all we could do to get everything operational that day, from the cafeteria to special areas. Every last minute of the day was a struggle. So I know that's a hard question to answer, Ralph, but.
And really, we need lunchroom monitors. I mean, not lunchroom, but lunch monitors for our classrooms.
Yeah.
I've done it 2 or 3 times over all Salem. And while it's rewarding, it's tiring, mm-hmm. as well, because I'm moving. I was doing 2 classes at the same time. But we're reaching out to church volunteers. We'll get them the background check,
yeah.
Give them a 30-minute orientation. Here's what you do during lunch, during a 30-minute lunch period. And we're reaching out to ESP as well. We're paying ESP, even the site directors, extra money if they choose to do that. And we had a sub-orientation today. We're doing sub-orientations weekly now, and we're going to do group interviews with subs. So we're getting it done. Barely, but we are getting it done. We're keeping our head above water, treading a little bit.
Mr. Richard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ringstaff, would it be fair to say that we are making our schools and our students as safe as we possibly can with the means that we have, and we're succeeding and doing better than other districts? Is that a fair statement?
That would be a correct statement. I don't know factual if we're doing better than other school districts. I just know what other school districts I'm seeing from other school districts. And when I talk to superintendents, sometimes I see myself bragging about what we're getting done in our schools compared to what they are. So I'm proud of our students and all of our employees, our parents. The only negative that we get from parents is when we have to quarantine their healthy child. And it's, the reason is we're very, very proactive, and it's to keep their healthy child healthy. That's the only reason we're quarantining. And we hate doing it.
All right, any other questions, comments?
I think a round of applause is appropriate, Mr. Chairman.
We do appreciate what you're doing, very much so. And I had a person on the street the other day ask me, he said, what are your school nurses doing? I didn't have all this information, but I think I remember who it was, and I'm going back to them, you know, because it's not, it was a job before COVID hit. It's even more so now. All right. Anything else we have tonight?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make an announcement.
Okay.
We give parents 2 weeks to change their option for the following 9 weeks. So after winter break, we start a new 9 weeks. And so we're giving our parents November 30th to December 14th. If their child is in distance learning, they want their child to come back after winter break. November 30th to December 14th is the timeline to make that decision, and vice versa. If they're a traditional learner that they want to go distance, that's the same way. We're going to try to contact all the parents who are currently in distance learning to see if they would like to come back traditional.
All right, any other business to come before the board?
Nothing further.
All right, I have a motion then for us to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you. Have a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, good night.
Good night.